All right, we are live here from Manhattan. Hello, everybody at goingfitbitbybit.com. Thank you so much for joining me tonight in Manhattan, New York. Hey, tonight, premises are provided by Mike Breslin, CPA and Esquire of the Full Serve Group on prestigious 57th Street in Manhattan, down the block from Carnegie Hall. The Full Serve Group is the tri-state area's go-to firm for all of your tax planning, estate planning, and tax preparation needs. Also, if you mess up on filing or not paying your taxes, they're very good at fixing that too, as well. Full Serve Group has helped me out many times with my company, and they do my taxes as well. So check them out, Full Serve Group. You can find them here in Manhattan. But let's go ahead and talk about goingfitbitbybit.com. A lot of fun things are happening. Tonight, we're going to be talking about fat burning, the history of dieting, intermittent fasting, and emotional eating. And I have prepared very well for this session, so we have a lot of material to go through. I can't wait to tell you all about it. Before we get deep dive into it, I hope some of you were up at 6 o'clock this morning, or at least checked out the video, because I have launched 6000by6.com, and we are getting 6,000 steps in at 6 o'clock in the morning, and it is happening, and it is fun, and I have finally hit my step goal. Let me see here if I can show you. I have finally hit my step goal. Oh, it's so bright. I don't know if you see screen by screen. Ah, there you go. You kind of see it there. Yeah, you can see how the green is all the way around. I finally hit my step goal in a day, even on a day that I work, as you can see, all dressed up here. All right, but let's dig into some of this material. All right, fat burning. So, we all want to burn fat, right? None of us want to have too much of the adipose tissue on our body. But let's think about this for a second. How is it that we actually burn fat? What does it take to burn fat? For instance, when we go to the gym, just because we're working out on that treadmill, are we burning fat? Are we burning fat when we're working out, or are we burning fat when we're stepping off the machine? Is it that we're burning fat when we're recovering from the machine, or are we only burning fat when we're doing weights, or are we only burning fat when we're done with weights? How do we know? When is it that we're burning fat? What exactly is happening? Well, listen, I did some investigation and I have some very specific answers for you. And this is gonna help you understand what it is we're actually doing here, okay? So, first of all, this is how the body actually burns fat, okay? When your body starts to expend more energy than it's consuming, okay? So when you're exercising, and by the way, a resting body every day, okay, expends approximately, depends on your size, of course, your body expends approximately 1,300 calories a day. Okay, so that's sort of the baseline that you're working with. You expend 1,300 calories a day. When you do not consume that 1,300 calories a day, or when you're exercising and then you increase how many calories you burn a day beyond that 1,300 calories, your body's cells rely on internally stored energy sources. Okay, and those are complex carbohydrates and fats for the energy. Okay, the first source that your body goes to is glycogen. Okay, and that glycogen is stored as a complex carbohydrate, and 65% of that is stored in the skeletal muscles, and pretty much the rest of that, rest of it is stored in the liver. Okay, so what happens is, your body's burning the 1,300 calories it burns every day. You decide to go to the gym, or you decide to go for just a big walk. And by the way, when I lost that 150 pounds, I never went to the gym, but I did take long walks. So this is what was happening to me. In the afternoon, I went on a mile and a half walk, or a 2.5 mile walk, right? All of a sudden, I boosted up that 1,300 calories to 1,800 calories, or 2,200 calories, or 2,700 calories, right? And what was I doing? I was all of a sudden depleting the glucose that was in my blood, the complex carbohydrates that were in my blood, and then my body started to use the glycogen that it had, right? Now, your body has approximately 2,000 calories of glycogen stored that it can use. Ah, okay. So now we've got the 1,300 plus another 2,000 that are stored in skeletal muscle and in the liver. Ah, okay. Well, what happens after that? Ah, you say. So first of all, understand that when it's burning when it's burning that glycogen, that's called glycogenolysis. Glycogenolysis. I'm sure I'm massacring that name, but glycogenolysis. When it's done burning that stored glycogen, that's when it starts to go after fat, and that's what we want, and that's lipolysis. That's when it starts to go after the fat. And so if you have not put something into your body, into your stomach, right, and you have gone ahead and depleted those stores of glycogen, your body will begin to burn the fat. So that is when your body starts to burn the fat and literally shed the weight off your body. Those fat cells are broken down into glycerol and fatty acids, and they're used to generate energy. Now, this is a fascinating thing. When your body burns fat, what do you think it turns it into? It turns it into two things, and only two things. And by the way, if we have any 5-year-olds watching or 7-year-olds watching, my children are 13, 11, and 7. As you know, it was all about poop for a while, right? By the way, they don't turn it into poop. When you burn fat, your body turns that fat into two things. And those two things are water and carbon dioxide. That's what your body turns the fat into. So you are literally peeing out your fat and breathing out your fat. Your body turns your fat into water and carbon dioxide. That's how your body is getting rid of your tummy, your thighs, your flappy wings on your arm, or wherever it is, your second and third chins that I have, whatever it is, that's how your body's actually getting rid of it. So think about that the next time you go pee after you've had a great day of exercising and a great food day. That's you getting rid of the fat. So that's all very fascinating to me, and this is going to tie into some other concepts that we're going to talk about today in terms of intermittent fasting. We already talked about 1,300 calories a day for the average person. Now, what's fascinating is, how much do you think the brain takes up of those 1,300 calories? Any guesses? Okay. Brain takes up about 300 of those calories. So about 20% of it. So your brain is burning 300 of the 1,300 calories. Now, I'm sure all of you knew that. I'm sure all of you knew that the brain chews up the bulk of the calories. Here's what is fascinating, though. If you were to go to take an exam or test and use your brain a lot more, while it uses slightly, and by the way, the brain literally uses sugar, so it uses the simple carbohydrate, glycogen, to think and to fire off those neurons, and that's a great thing, right? Okay, at least the brain's helping us out, right? The brain's sucking in the glycogen for us, because we want to get that glycogen, for the most part, out of our system, I mean, especially if we're eating too much, right? So at least the brain's helping us out when we're thinking. But the reality is, while there have been many academic studies that have measured this, and they can measure, very, very tiny differences in the brain actually using this glycogen, the reality is, in terms of calorie intake, whether you're taking an exam or whether you're just sitting there doing nothing, has almost no impact on calories. Fascinating, right? So you could sit there and do mathematic tests and read Latin all day long and struggle with your brain all day long, and you would be adding an insignificant amount of calories being burned to your overall total, which is fascinating considering that the brain is the organ or the part of the body that's chewing up so much of your calories all the time of that 1,300 calories. Conversely, right, you know, those thighs, especially anybody out there who did the 6,000 by 6 this morning, right? We worked those thighs really hard this morning, 6000by6.com. We're gonna do it again tomorrow morning, right? Conversely, those thighs, you start working those thighs just a little bit, boom, you use a lot of calories, right? Those calories just poosh, peel right away. And then that's when we use all that glycogen. And how much glycogen do we store? 65% of it in the skeletal muscles, much of the rest of it in the liver. We store 2,000 calories worth, right? So we're trying to burn through that 2,000 calories worth. And then what does our body do? Our body starts to work on fat. Yes, yes, that's what it starts to do. Yes, love it. Okay, all right, so that is a lot about fat. The last thing, the last thing I want to say about brains and thinking is, this is kind of fascinating. So why is it that we get done with exams, right? And I know a lot of us haven't taken exams in a long time, but why is it that kids get done with exams, or when we got done with exams, why is it that we were so mentally exhausted and drained? Or, all right, why is it that after we've had some rough conversations with our teenagers, right, why is it that we are so mentally drained, right? Conversely, why is it that if we spent 2 or 3 hours doing a crossword puzzle that we were excited about, or we watched a 2.5 hour biopic on television that was fascinating, that was working our brain like mad, why is it that when we're done with those things that we enjoy, that are using our brain so much, we don't feel exhausted, but when we're done with something like exams, that we do feel exhausted? What's going on there? What is happening? Why is that? You know, we don't really know for sure, but I'm going to posit it's all about attitude. That's what I'm going to posit. It's all about attitude. Because essentially you're using your brain in the same way, right? And in both cases, your brain is being used in an extraordinary way, and you're having to think a lot, right? But in the one, you're having to think a lot, and you're having a lot of stress, right? Stress is involved, right, with the exams. And in the other, there aren't a lot of stressors involved. As a matter of fact, if anything, there's some pleasure sensory things going on. So anyway, that's just something to think about. Last but not least, and some of these topics we may dive into on other online meetups. I just wanted to throw out there, because we touched on the liver, and you know, if you'll notice, we're starting to see these themes, right? There's these themes of carbohydrates, these themes of diabetes, these themes of the liver, right? We're going to definitely have a session on fatty liver disease and NASH, if you want to look it up, NASH, and we're going to talk about that. Anyhow, these are all things that we want to explore and talk about. So we understand how our bodies are working and just how important it is for us to go to goingfitbitbybit.com. And fantastic news. If you've gone out there to register at goingfitbitbybit.com, which essentially means you've just gone out and given us your email address by signing up, email address, we have now, I believe it was an Alta HR and a Charge HR that Fitbit has sent us. And we're going to be giving those away to the people who've been coming to these online meetups. So please go out there and register. That's how I know you're actually on the online meetup, okay? Please go ahead and do that. And pass that along. If you've talked to anybody, said, oh yeah, I saw that crazy McDaddy doing that going fit bitbybit.com stuff. Or, oh, I was with him on the 6000by6.com. I saw him on that crazy video. Also, all that stuff is also posted out at my YouTube channel. And please subscribe to my YouTube channel. I would greatly appreciate that. Oh, also, before I move on, tonight you will notice there is a donate button down here somewhere. A donate button. That's for Diabetes, American Diabetes Foundation, American Diabetes Association. please, it is the season of giving. If you wouldn't mind making a small contribution to the American Diabetes Association, again, I've mentioned before, I set up goingfitbitbybit.com as a public benefit corporation, and we are doing our best to do everything to eliminate obesity, and one of the byproducts of obesity, of course, is type 2 diabetes. All right, let's move on. We covered fat burning. I know we took a lot of time on that, 15 minutes, but let's talk about this next topic. History of dieting. History of dieting. Five people. First thing I want to say is, all right, I'm going to make you all think back to your school days. How long humans been on the planet? All right, I'll make it quick, 200,000 years. But how long have we had civilization? Best we can figure, maybe about 6,000 years. All right, how long have we had dieting? How long has dieting been around? As far as we can tell, even though humans have been here 200,000 years, even though civilization has been here 6,000 years, we have only been successful enough in growing food and having it available to a large enough population on a regular basis to actually have this problem of fat people and obesity, to have dieting around. Are you ready for this? How long do you think we've had dieting around? About 280, 290 years. That's how long dieting's been around, as far as we can tell, and as far as my research could drum up. That's amazing. It's only been around 280, 290 years. Why is that? Well, because prior to 280 and 290 years ago, there weren't any literate societies around that were successful enough for a long enough period, right, that grew enough food, right, to actually have a lot of fat people running around to say, oh my God, there's too many fat people, what are we gonna do, right? So this problem of obesity and diet and this type 2 diabetes and all this stuff, this is actually a really kind of new problem for us as humans. This is a sort of a brand new problem. In a way, if you wanted to compare it to technology, this is like a smartphone for us. You know what I mean? This is like something that's just brand new. We've never really had this kind of thing before. This is like going to space. You know, we've only been there once or twice. All right, some of the guys, I'm gonna cover this quickly, really quickly, because it's not that important, but it is important, but one of the guys, William Banting, this guy, William Banting, 1863, William Banting had a pamphlet come out, letter on corpulence, addressed to the public. He outlined the details of a particular low-carbohydrate, low-calorie diet. There you go. First low-carbohydrate, low-calorie diet was in 1863 by William Banting. You ready for this? This guy's profession? He was an undertaker. Gotta love that. George Chain, gotta love this guy. George Chain, this guy was extremely fat. He himself had type 2 diabetes. His claim to fame, he went meatless, and he prescribed meatless diets to everybody. He said, the way to go is to have a meatless diet. He did that in 1724. He wrote an essay. It was called An Essay of Health and Long Life. He advocated exercise and fresh air and avoiding the luxury foods, okay? Very quickly, John Rollo was a Scottish military surgeon. The Scots got involved here. He published the Notes of a Diabetic Case in 1797, where what he did is he said, listen, we found benefit by going on a meat diet for those people who have diabetes. They had just discovered diabetes in 1797, around about that time. And they put these people on a meat diet and found, obviously, benefit, right? So they're feeding them all protein and no carbs. And Dobson helped him out with that, Matthew Dobson. Dobson discovered being able to discover glucose in the urine. glucose in the urine. And last but not least, going all the way up into the 20th century, Lulu Hunt Peters really had the first bestseller, if you will, in 1918. It was called Diet and Health. with key to the calories by with key to the calories. It was the very, very first time that anybody advocated counting calories. And by the way, we don't really count calories when we do going fitbitbybit.com. The Fitbit really does it for you. You just put in what you eat. So anyway, that's just sort of, that just kind of frames this out for you. Very, very, very new problem. All right, so let me talk to you now about a technique. Now, first of all, I want you to understand, I don't want us to get too far ahead of ourselves here, right? For those of you who went out and got Fitbits, fantastic. For those of you who've signed up for our program at goingfitbitbybit.com, fantastic. Some of you are entering into personal coaching now with me. And by the way, I just want to tell you, I'm now interviewing other personal trainers and personal coaches to come on and work for Going Fit goingfitbitbybit.com because I know that I'm going to hit my threshold of, I don't know if it's going to be 50 people or 70 people, but I'm going to hit a threshold of where I'm going to feel like, okay, I'm not sure I can still provide fantastic service. So I'm going to have other professional coaches there ready to go to provide professional service there. So if you haven't signed up yet, now's the time to sign up. Because I think I'm a great coach and I can be your coach. So go ahead and do that. But let me talk to you about a technique that I use, and I don't think I used this until like month 12, month 13. So this was way far down the line, but the technique's called intermittent fasting, okay? And this gets back to our discussion that we had, just check time, 8:21. This gets back to the discussion we had at the very beginning around fat and fat burning, right? And this is why intermittent fasting works, right? So everybody knows about eating small meals and eating them throughout the day and keeping your body fed and this sort of thing. Do I believe in that? Yes, I do believe in that. I lost a lot of weight doing that. My first 50 pounds, whoosh, came off doing that. From June 30th, 2016, to Thanksgiving, I lost 50 pounds, whoosh. By eating small meals, by eating the same ratio of grams protein to fat to carbohydrate, okay? So that's how I like to start people off. Eat the same ratio of grams to fat to protein to carbohydrate. Do the best you can there. Wear your Fitbit 24/7, so it's measuring your metabolic rate, and put all the food that you're eating in to your smartphone as you go, and Fitbit's gonna tell you when to stop, don't eat anymore, and then it'll tell you green light, nope, it's okay, you can have a little bit more food, and it's as simple as that. You're gonna meet your goal that you set in your Fitbit, and you're gonna lose weight. You're gonna step on your ARIA scale every morning, and you're gonna see the results. Results are gonna happen, which is why we give you a money-back guarantee. The money-back guarantee is all about, you know what you have to do? You have to actually just show us that you put everything into your phone and they actually followed your own plan. That's what you have to show us, because we know if you do that, guess what? You're gonna lose the weight you wanna lose. It's pretty simple, very, very simple stuff, right? Okay, but I'm here and I'm gonna tell you a little bit about intermittent fasting, because it is kind of an interesting thing. So why does intermittent fasting work? Okay, so what is intermittent fasting? Very simply, if you're gonna intermittent fast daily, this is what it is. It's eating, for instance, okay, and this is how I've done it. It's eating between 1 p.m. and 8 p.m. only. Only eating between 1 p.m. and 8 p.m. Now, why would we only eat between 1 p.m. and 8 p.m. every day? Let's think about that for a second. Okay, so if I finish my last meal at 8 p.m., okay, and I don't have anything. I don't have my Michelob Ultras. I don't have anything after 8 p.m. Okay, and that's the last food I take in. And now we start counting. What did we say? A normal person burns 1,300 calories a day. So let's start that day for our purposes at 8 p.m. Okay, so 1,300 calories a day. Now we can increase that by a little exercise. So let's say I get up in the next morning and I exercise. Let's say I exercise enough to add another 1,200 calories to that. Okay, now I'm up to, to what, 2,500 calories, right? Easily in that 24-hour period, 2,500 calories. Okay, well, I haven't put anything in my system since 8 p.m. the night before. Okay, so pretty much by the time I started exercise that next morning, my body's empty, right? It's gone to what? It went to the glycogen stores, right? So, and where are those? 65% of them are in the skeletal muscles. Pretty much the rest of them are in the liver. And it burned through those. And then what did it do? It went to the fat, right? It went and burned the adipose, right? And it burned the adipose, burned the adipose, burned the adipose. And then after it burned the fat, around about 1 o'clock, what happened? I started eating. Started having food around 1 o'clock. I'd go to Dunkin' Donuts and get my large coffee with extra half and half in it. Thank you very much. Go have my banana, whatever it was. And frankly, for me, that wasn't a problem. I didn't get hungry. It wasn't an issue for me at that point. Now again, did I start off this way? No. No. I'm going to say I had already lost 90 pounds at this point before I started intermittent fasting. Let me just read you a couple notes around this. I don't want to go over our time on intermittent fasting because I do one other thing I want to talk about. We just have a few minutes left. Here are some benefits of it. Intermittent fasting is simple. It's very, very simple. Eat between 1 and 8. So that's very true. Intermittent fasting has been literally proven to prolong your length of life, okay? Let me just read this. Apparent prolongation of the lifespan of rats by intermittent fasting. Okay, that this is a rather old study, but it was 1946. And I can post these notes if you like. In fact, I kind of wonder who's watching and who's interested in this stuff. So please reach out to me. Let me know. Put it in the comments. American Society for Clinical Nutrition, alternate day fasting and chronic disease prevention. So intermittent fasting has been shown to reduce the risks of cancer and cardiovascular disease. Alternate day fasting and chronic disease prevention, a review of human and animal trials. So that's, it's pretty clear. So because of those reasons, we know that intermittent fasting is actually a healthy thing, not a bad thing. So think about adding that into your repertoire of tools. Last but not least, and this is another topic that I think I would spend an entire meeting on at some point, but I wanted to touch on it because it's something that I know I do, and it is tough, and it's emotionally. So you add one of those days, you come home, and you go through the garage, and what room do you come into after you go through your mud room or your room where you take your shoes off or whatever it might be? What room do you come into in your house? Come on. What room does everybody come into in the house and gather at? The kitchen. That's right. And I'm actually kind of convinced that the size of our kitchens has contributed, and the size of our refrigerators has contributed to the size of our guts. Because it didn't used to be that way. You go back and look at homes in from 100, 150 years ago, these kitchens were not this large, and frankly, the kitchens were not the center of the home. Right now, it's all around the refrigerator, the food, the sink, the stove, the entire home, right? And so what does that encourage us to do? Eat. Anyhow, and I wouldn't be surprised if we begin to see in home building a shift away from that. I would not be surprised. Mark my words now. Okay, but anyhow, we had a hard day. We're upset about something, whatever it is. Here's how it works for me. You know what? My Fitbit says green. I want some corn chips. I'm going to have some corn chips. 10 corn chips. 10 corn chips. Put my 10 corn chips in. Oh, salty. That was good. You know what? I'm going to have those pistachio and almond mix. those in. Wow, that was a lot of fat. Ooh, that's a lot of calories. I'm all the way up to red. I really want some cheese. All right, I'm going to have some cheese. All right, the cheese leads me to ice cream. Oh, God, now I'm having ice cream. What's the matter with me? Oh, the ice cream leads me to beer. Now I'm having Michelob Ultras. Oh, before I know it, I'm sitting there picking through roast beef slices. And, you know, before I know it, I'm going to bed. I'm upset with myself. Instead of being 1,000 calories under for the day, I'm either at what I burned or I'm 1,000 calories over, and I've ruined all the work that I've done, and I ruined all that work within 50 minutes, right? Or 15 minutes even. It happens. So first of all, let me tell you this one thing. Here's my quote. We cannot choose or change what we want, but we can choose how we respond, how we respond to or act on that desire. That's what we can change. Okay? We can't change the fact that we want some of that crap, right? But we can change how we respond to that desire to have it, or how we act on or don't act on that desire. Okay? So the first thing is to recognize that you're in that state of mind, right? The second thing is to know what's triggering it, right? And then get yourself the hell out of there, right? Go for a walk. Get out of that kitchen. Get out of that house. Go for a walk. That's one thing. My new thing, go straight to bed. Get out of that kitchen upstairs, straight to bed. Get out of that kitchen. But here are some other things. And these are some other things to try. And then we're going to wrap this up here tonight because we're already a minute over. But don't forget to give yourself some pleasure. But no, really, make sure that you include pleasure in your overall plan, okay? And last but not least, and I tell my hockey kids this all the time as a coach, remember the lesson, but forget the mistake, okay? Forget the mistake, but remember the lesson. And last but not least, if you find, and I haven't come across this yet in coaching people with goingfitbitbybit.com, but I have found this being an employer before, and that is if you find that you are having difficulty managing control around emotional eating, this is a support network, right? We're here for you, okay? But just because we're part of your support network doesn't mean that we're not going to need to add other things or other people to your support network to make this work, okay? So we may need to add, in fact, I encourage you to add your regular doctor to the support network, right? But we may need to add, you know, a therapist, right? We may need to add medication. We may need to add a psychiatrist. We may need to add a dietitian. We need an appropriate support network that's going to make you successful. We're going to start with going fit. bitbybit.com, because remember, it all begins with